silence your phone, sure, but considering this is a talk about social media, please film, please Snapchat, Insta story, do anything you want, because what this talk and hopefully what this space and convention is all about is, you know, using this platform as a place for us to get excited, a ripple effect, to do our own activism in the real world. So hopefully we can exchange contact with people, go to dinner, maybe conduct some protests like I'll show in this presentation to get excited. So yeah, my name is Jackson. Just get a raise of hands just so I see how I cater this talk. How many of you are familiar with my YouTube videos? Just raise your hand. All right, maybe a little less than half. That is perfect. So this talk is really mainly the story of how I went from a very skeptic user of social media to the point where you'll see where I completely rejected it entirely, to the point where I get on all of these platforms like Snapchat and YouTube and Instagram and Facebook that, depending on what generation you're from, not trying to stereotype anyone, but maybe think of as these very ego-driven platforms to show an inauthentic picture of your life. I use social media as a tool in a completely different way, hopefully to make the world more sustainable, healthy, a more compassionate place, and I'm going to tell you the story of how that happened, hopefully to inspire you that really anybody can do this, and if you have a message and a voice, you can really get it out to the world. So I'm of the social media generation. My coming of age, you could say, coincided with, you know, getting a MySpace account and getting Facebook. You know, I got MySpace probably when I was 11 or 12 years old. Like, all I know is, you know, being on social media, except for very faint memories of not having the internet. Truly, that's my life. That's my generation. And obviously, I use social media in the exact same way that probably all of us, when we were first navigating with stuff in the mid or early 2000s, used it. And here's a picture. You can laugh. Totally laugh. This whole presentation is supposed to be funny. Because looking back at your social media pictures is always cringeworthy and hilarious. But these were the kinds of pictures circa 2008 of when I started posting on social media. Now, there's nothing wrong with taking pictures of your friends on the weekend at parties and posting them for your social circle. I'm not shaming that at all, but I clearly had a vision to put this picture up. I wanted my friends to know that I was spending the weekend with my cool friends in their cool house, letting them know what I was doing. And it really was, you know, I did that for many years, growing up in middle school and high school. Think about these pretty fragile times for a teenager who's trying to figure out who they are, trying to get up in the hierarchical social circle. And it wasn't until midway through high school that I really started to question this stuff, and I started to feel the impacts. You know, when we're so exposed to what our friends and social circles are doing at every given moment, I'm sure all of you deep down can relate to when you saw your friend on Facebook at a party that maybe you weren't invited to. And that probably doesn't make you feel that good. And you see, you know, friends hanging out without you, and while some people, maybe I use social media to boost my ego in the beginning, that probably related to hurting someone's feelings in the end. So I was like, this stuff is toxic. You know, taking a social media detox, probably to most of you, sounds like a really healthy thing, right? If you tell your friend at the, you know, juice bar, yeah, I'm not going on Snapchat for 2 weeks, I'm not on Facebook, you know, go, wow, that's awesome, because it's toxic, right? And that's how I really viewed it, and that's how it was growing up in Los Angeles, you know, as a young kid who grew up with social media. So I stand up for myself. So I decided to reject it entirely. And what I did was, right after graduating high school, I decided to take some time off before going to college, take a gap year, do some traveling, have some real world experiences, and I deleted my Facebook. I didn't have a Snapchat or Instagram or whatever. I had a flip phone at the time. I literally turned off my phone for an entire year. and I decided to ride my bicycle across the United States. I was a vegetarian at the time. Just have real life experiences, live fully in the moment, not having to do some activity in order to post it to Instagram or Facebook account, and just reject these platforms entirely. I had a great time, I bummed around, I biked across the United States, I went and traveled in Asia, volunteered on an orangutan sanctuary in the middle of the jungle, felt the liberation of being fully disconnected from a phone, from a social media platform that probably nowadays we all feel that pull and connection that we need to keep updating our social framework. And throughout that year of detaching, traveling for an entire year, especially as a young kid, I turned 19 on my gap year, you lose a lot of control, right? We're so used to, if you have a home, if you have a kitchen, you have your phone on you, it's a very controlling behavior, and you feel really good because you can know where you're going. There's a lot of control around not traveling, and when you do travel, that's the beauty of it, right? Getting out of your comfort zone, but it can also be scary. And towards the end of my gap year, two things happened. In the long run, both were great essential parts of my journey, but the first awesome thing that happened was, I had this year just to think, not be in a strict academic setting, and somehow, I can't explain it in this short time we have together, but 2 weeks before starting my freshman year of college, at the end of my gap year, I decided it was a good idea to go completely sober and go vegan. Not the best way to make friends going into your freshman year of college, but that's what happened to me. And I'm so thankful for that now. But the second thing that happened, and I think this has to do with having this full year of being so out of my own control, is that I developed certain ways to control my life and my environment, and unfortunately that unfolded in me controlling my behavior with my food, to the point where I developed an eating disorder that I could call orthorexia, where you become so obsessed with the nutritional quality of every single thing that you put in your mouth, which I'm sure a lot of people in the vegan community and maybe even in this room can relate to, that when you learn this powerful information from Forks Over Knives and China Study and oil-free, high-carbohydrate, vegan lifestyle, while it's great to practice that 80% of your life, it's best for longevity, it's best for athletic performance and all of that, being too controlling over things like that can actually limit your ability to live and to eat socially. And what happened was, it led me to the point where I'm 6'2", I was 140 pounds, pretty severely underweight. I thought I wanted to be an athlete, but I had no energy because I was restricting so much and preparing just all of my own food that I really didn't have the proper energy to be good at any sport. I was extremely antisocial my first 2 years of college because I wasn't engaging in a lot of the community-based activities like eating, drinking, partying. I was going to bed early and making all of my own meals. And it was really important for me to learn about nutrition and learn about how I wanted to live my life, but hey, everyone has ups and downs and struggle, and that's an important part of life, and this was sort of the valley where I just didn't know what to do. It lasted for about 2 years, despite my friends and family trying to tell me that clearly this diet isn't working. I was trying to just pull and say, no, I just have to get through this peak. I don't know why it's not working right now. It just turned out, I had an eating disorder and I didn't admit it to myself for about 2 years. But finally, I couldn't take it anymore. And I could see what it was doing to my social life, and my best friends who I would talk to and, were there for me all the time, just slowly fading away. Because I was honestly really selfish. I was spending so much time working out and preparing my own food that I didn't leave enough time for the other people in my life. And about halfway through college, my sophomore year, I decided that I had to do something about it. And now I was super embarrassed to confront any of my friends or family about it, because especially as a young 19-year-old male, that's not what we typically think of as a person to have an eating disorder. Although now that I'm an advocate for overcoming this, and I'll get to that in the lecture, I've seen a flood of emails and messages of men my age, you know, coming out in a way that they have this issue too. So it definitely exists. For some reason, men just aren't as comfortable sharing it, and that's something that I'm trying to change as well. But I decided to nip this thing in the butt and do something about it. And the reason that I decided at this time was that I was really becoming so passionate about promoting, you know, a vegan diet to my peers in college that I started to do some lectures, do some speaking, have speakers come to my school. And I kept getting over and over again to from my friends, dude, like, your diet definitely saves the animals, that's awesome, I think it's probably the healthiest, it's great for the environment. I don't want to look like you, so why should I follow your diet? And I was just like, shit, that's true. What do I do about this? So, for the first time in many years, I decided, maybe there's people on social media that have been talking about this. And remember, I'm still totally disconnected. It was like my thing. It actually boosted my ego that I didn't have a social media platform. So the reason that I went into that for the first place of trying to be more grounded, it turned out to flip itself over. And I was like, I need some help here. I'm going to turn to the internet. And so what did I do? I looked on YouTube. I looked on Facebook, on Instagram. And slowly, I just started to tap into all these different platforms and see that people were talking about this. People could give me help talking about their eating disorders. And I also saw, you know, vegan athletes from, you know, Rich Roll, Robert Cheek, Tori Washington, these big, strong, incredible vegan men that I wanted to be that. Because I do this 99% for the animals. I care about health, I care about sustainability, but I, you know, am all about animal liberation. And I knew that I wasn't being the best advocate for what I wanted to promote. And if I was this big, strong, you know, vegan powerhouse, that would be one better way to get my message across. So, and again, you can keep laughing. I started to work out. I started to lift some weights and put up really silly pictures on social media, like when I got an Instagram, which was a little over 2 years ago. And I said, okay, if I want to change my body, if I want to change my life, I'm gonna, one, document it on the internet to stay accountable. It's a great way to stay accountable because people are gonna be commenting and seeing your progress. And second, I was thinking maybe I could help one or two people if I have success in this transformation, just like I got help from people on the internet, vegan athletes that gave me so much help and inspiration. So what did I do? I posted really silly pictures. And I made really, now that I rewatch them, cringeworthy, embarrassing videos from when I was just, you know, early off of my eating disorder, trying to change my life around. And it wasn't until I really got some real results, going from 140 pounds in that picture to the left, in like a year and a half, I was up to 165 pounds at a very similar leanness level. So really building real vegan muscle, not using supplements. You know, I'm not a professional bodybuilder up here, but there's a clear difference in my physique, and I was really proud of it, and I was sharing it online. And it's really once you put those transformation pictures up that, you know, I probably, just like most of you, had a few followers on Instagram, a few followers on Snapchat and YouTube. Wasn't anything. It wasn't a business. I couldn't call myself a brand or a platform. But I started making videos like that, you know, why I'm vegan video that I showed you. And I made a video called My Male Eating Disorder Story that right now has, you know, a little over 20,000 views. And when I posted that, I got a ton of new followers and new emails from people. And I was like, huh, that's interesting. I posted a video of me being as vulnerable as possible, just talking about pretty much what I told you guys just now, but to the entire freaking planet to see, which is a really scary thing. And not everyone is cut out to do that. I was inspired enough and motivated to tell that story. And I started to get some emails, and I'm gonna tell you a story of one of them from this guy named Jack. This picture was taken this summer, earlier this summer, and I host Fruit Lux now with my girlfriend Izzy, who's also has a pretty similar story to me actually, but she's a vegan YouTuber as well in the Berkeley area, and we're gonna have Fruit Lux all the time here, so hopefully we'll see you there. We don't have one planned right now, but soon. So we host Fruit Lux. It's like a vegan potluck where you can bring fruit and we hang out together and, you know, eat. And Jack is 16 years old. He came up to me at this Fruit Lux a few weeks ago, and he said, "Hey, Jack, I'm in high school. I just took the train over here. I begged my mom to let me come from San Diego to meet you, Jackson, because a few months ago, I was in a really bad eating disorder for about a year, and I had to quit being on the cross-country team because I just couldn't. My doctors wouldn't let me work out anymore. My performance was declining, and, you know, I was hit with this in high school. I wasn't vegan at the time. I went to YouTube. I stumbled across your eating disorder story, which was the number one thing that inspired me to go get professional help and to go vegan. And I've been vegan now for like 4 months. I've gained a bunch of weight. I'm back on the cross country team. And I'm actually proud of the food I eat. I get chills even telling the story because I get a lot of emails from people, but Jack, just to hear that story face to face from me, just sticking a camera in front of my face like anyone can do, no fancy edits, and just being vulnerable and communicating my struggles, which we all have struggles of one thing or another that could help others. And, you know, now, and just hearing that story, and Jack and I are still in communication. We're good friends. On the left, he's now, and I helped him throughout this whole thing, is giving talks in his high school and every class he's in about veganism. And the picture on the right was posted on July 4th this year. I'm taking out my phone now because I'm gonna go to Jack's Instagram, which is Jack's Vegan Recovery. Should all go follow him, he'd be stoked. And this is a caption, this is an Instagram post, the picture of him on the podium from July 4th, this past July 4th, just a few months ago. Here's the caption. 1 year ago today, I was in the midst of my eating disorder. I was consuming low vibration, poisonous animal products. I ran the community 10K race on 4th of July, thinking about what I would eat when I got home and how I would restrict at the 4th of July party. I think he was 15 or when he's talking about this. I got 4th place in the race, but my running was soon to crash as my body gave out and then was no longer allowed to run at all. Today, I ran the 10K race a very different person. I ran today as a person in recovery with the most of my eating disorder behind me. I ran today as a vegan. I ran today far more mature, far more compassionate, and far more in the moment. Today I ran for the 160 billion animals killed every year. Today I ran to beat an eating disorder. Today I also ran for myself, for my life, not my eating disorder's life, not any other person's judgment or perceptions. And today, I may have won the race, but far more important was why I ran and what I ran for. And it gives me chills because his story is just so beautiful and he's just such a nice guy. And he's on Instagram too, now trying to, you know, do things that I started doing just 2 years ago at a similar age as him. So I don't only talk about food and eating disorders on my YouTube channel at all. What I use my YouTube platform is really to communicate anything in my life that I believe in and that has benefited me. So everything from yoga, spirituality, fitness, veganism, obviously, animal rights, but I can use it for, use this platform for so many different things once you build a platform of people who watch your videos. And I think we have, we've got time. I'll show this video, which was filmed a few days ago. I posted this on YouTube just a couple days ago. I just moved to Berkeley, and I got involved with a group called Direct Action Everywhere. If you don't know them, they're just a really awesome animal rights community activist group here in Berkeley. I'll talk a little bit more about them after. But here's a video that I posted on YouTube just a few days ago. Let's watch it. So this afternoon, the Berkeley DXC crew and I on film duty are going to go disrupt the Whole Foods market. We're going to sing a song, do a speak out on behalf of animal liberation, sing some more, do some chanting, and then exit. The speak outs are a way to get into your local community for people that are shopping for groceries. We're allowed to express ourselves in a public space. We also make people slightly uncomfortable because they're not used to people singing and chanting about animal rights within a Whole Foods market. But it's not violent. We're all about nonviolence. We're just here to get people to think, especially going to a Whole Foods market where they do what I call humane washing, where they convince their customers that the meat and fish and dairy and all the animal products sourced at their store come from happy animals who want to give their bodies and their products away. That's obviously not the case. So one of the other reasons that we choose to speak out at a Whole Foods is that the average person coming to a Whole Foods market is just a little bit maybe more conscious or aware of their food choices. Maybe they want to eat more sustainably, more ethically. So we feel like talking about the vegan message and animal rights message in that setting may cater more to the people really making action. Secondly, is this fact of humane washing that I discussed, which is that Whole Foods really tries to get people to feel good about their meat choices and purchasing the animal products. We obviously believe that humane meat does not exist. We believe in animal liberation and not eating animal products whatsoever, eating passionately and sustainably. And we feel that Whole Foods is actually going against people going vegan ultimately because they make people proud of their meat and dairy choices. Here we go.
But unfortunately, other animals are still suffering. There are females
So here's a teaser to get you to go check out my YouTube channel. That's only like 70% of the video. There's some more stuff in there. We do some chanting as we exit the Whole Foods, and then I do a little interview with Sarah, who is the activist that didn't speak out, about like why speak outs are effective and why she does it. So the reason that I showed you that is there's a lot of this on social media. These are my photos. I put up food pornography all the time. That's what this is. And this is okay. This gets some people who are browsing Instagram who maybe aren't vegan at all, who want a pie recipe, a peach pie recipe. Maybe they hashtag peach pie. They see how beautiful my fully raw vegan peach pie is, and maybe they'll make that recipe. So sure, posting pretty pictures of foods is good. It's not an inherently bad thing, a selfish thing to do. But in my opinion, while this talk is about social media activism, I can use my real feet on the ground activism, like us going into a place of violence like Whole Foods and disrupting in our own community, non-violently, of course. And if you have questions as to why we did that kind of protest, I'd be happy to talk about it after this. But you can do whatever you want on social media. That protest affected maybe the 50 to 60 people that were in the Whole Foods there in Berkeley, and maybe got them to think about their choices when they were picking out dinner. But because I put that video on YouTube, you know, it's gotten out to multiple thousand people in a few days, and the power of sharing, you can use that kind of activism to spread to a much wider audience. So my message here is, hopefully through listening to my story, there's nothing that made me qualified to, you know, build kind of this small business that I've made now just from making YouTube videos. And, you know, I'm not the most successful YouTuber out there, but I have a significant platform that's growing of people from all over the world that watch my videos. And the way it happened were these three components that I want to tell you, and hopefully you can really take these, you know, three tips to heart if you too want to share online and have a platform, even if you think you have no responsibility doing so, if you don't have great stage presence. I didn't have any of these things, but I did three things with my social media that really made a difference. Number one was having a purpose. Sure, there are some people online that have had success that have absolutely no purpose at all. Kardashians are a perfect example of that. But I'm sure none of you want to be thought of in the mainstream community like a Kardashian, probably, although I shouldn't judge or stereotype. But if you have a purpose behind what you do, there's a much, you know, people will take you much more seriously and will be interested in what you have to say. Number two is vulnerability, and this is probably the most important thing. Being on social media doesn't mean anymore that you have to put on perfect makeup and have a perfect body and great stage presence. In fact, the reason I've had some success is because I've been able to just turn the camera on at random points throughout my day and speak from my heart and speak about my lowest points in life. That's what real people are interested in watching. No one wants, you know, that Hollywood is for actors and for green screens. YouTube and social media is for real people connecting about real issues and telling stories. So be vulnerable. Share the things that you hope other people who are sharing your struggles can learn from you if you've had some success overcoming them, whatever they may be. This transcends just veganism. It can be about anything that you've had in your life if you want to help people. And then number three is consistency. Think about if you meet a new friend and you don't hear back from them, and you talk to them for 5 minutes, like watching a 5-minute YouTube video, and then you don't hear back from them for a month, you're probably not going to develop, you know, a hardcore relationship with that person. It's the same thing online. If you want to build a platform, you need to post consistently. During my second semester of my senior year of college, which was just a few months ago, I posted a YouTube video every single day. Just try to think back to when social media was being created and how you thought about it, just as I thought about it, where it was a place to show your selfies and show an authentic version of what you really are. This is what social media is to me now. This is that free love where I met Jack. You can see him up in the corner, I'm back there, my girlfriend's in the middle. I met my girlfriend through YouTube and through Fruit Lux. Especially in the vegan community, we actually interact with each other. We may meet on social media, you have so many people playing that up. Social media, killing these kids' communication skills. They're just gonna text in their bedroom and they're not gonna be able to, you know, make real friends. My closest friends have come now because I met them on social media and we actually meet and share food and hug each other and do acro yoga and work out and hang out with each other. So this is just a typical fruit luck of what can happen if you have a social media platform, post online, which takes you 2 minutes from your underwear and your bed, and then you can be hanging out in real life with tons of people. So I really believe social media is like, you know, a knife. You can use a knife to harm other beings, or you can use it to chop up a salad and have an extremely healthy dinner. If you want to make, you know, real change, especially in 2016, we need to be on social media. You can use social media to post inauthentic selfies claiming you have this perfect life with no problems, or you can use social media to help people like Jack out there that actually need it. Social justice movements in the past, from, you know, women's suffrage movement, civil rights movement, those succeeded with actual human beings on the ground because we didn't have stuff like social media. And we need still, as vegan activists, to do that kind of activism 100%, which is why I am involved in the protest community and stuff like that. But, you know, who's to say that gay marriage would be legalized in the United States last year if it wasn't for social media? I mean, this is a real form of activism that social justice movements are obviously all using. Black Lives Matter and so on, but I just want to inspire people to get on these platforms to make the world more healthy, more compassionate, and a more sustainable place. So thank you guys so much for listening to my talk.